Welcome to session one of our teaching series on conversations that matter. And hopefully you've had a chance to watch the introductory piece on your own time or with your group. So we're going to start with John 1, where Jesus calls his first soon-to-be disciples. And what is the context and the background to this conversation?
Well, this is later in that first chapter, and the book opens up in chapter 1 with John establishing that Jesus has indeed been sent by God, and that Jesus is God the Son in human flesh. And he says, as we saw him walk among us, he says, we saw someone full of grace and truth. He reflected the Heavenly Father in grace and truth. And that grace and truth will become important in our understanding of healthy conversations and looking at Jesus' conversations with others. And then Jesus, now a man at age 30, is walking along the River Jordan. And John the Baptist, who God had sent to be the forerunner, announcing to the Jews that the Messiah is about to arrive, he says, and there he is. Behold, the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world. And so John is the first one really to use words as the gospel unfolds to describe who Jesus is. John the Baptist particularly says it to those who've been following him. And he's got some disciples who've been following him. And now he says, my whole point was to point to that individual. There he is, the Lamb of God. So two of his disciples break away and they start to follow Jesus. And that's where the conversation begins.
So these two disciples leave John and they follow Jesus.
Yeah.
What do they know about Jesus at this point?
These are fishermen. In that day, fishing wasn't a bad occupation because this was a basic staple of life, the fish coming from the Sea of Galilee, and there was a demand in the region for the fish coming from the sea. And so these are pretty significant people in the culture of the day, and they have given themselves to follow John that the Messiah is coming. So now you can imagine they've anticipated this. They're ready. If you're the Messiah, so they just start following him. Mm-hmm. And he turns and he asks the first question. It's the very first comment of Jesus in the book, first dialogue from him, a question. Over 300 questions in the life of Christ. And here's the first one.
It's such a great question. What do you want?
Right.
Why do you think he opens with this?
I like it because he starts with where they are. And I think one of the key things we learn in this dialogue in John 1 with Jesus and these, as you called them, soon-to-be disciples, is that he has a very hospitable, inviting spirit where he starts where they are. He doesn't turn and say, okay, guys, here's the plan. Mm-hmm. He says, what do you want? What's your interest?
It's kind of simple.
Jesus never starts the conversation the same way. There's no formula. There's no trick that he's using. It's a relationship. If there's anything that perhaps is the most common denominator, is that he begins with where the person is and what they're looking for. What do you want out of life? What can I do for you? What's this conversation? Why are you here? It's very invitational. And I think we learn a lot there.
What's interesting about this question, and we'll see that Jesus asks this type of question a lot, where you could take it at face value. What do you want? Could be, I just want to follow you. I mean, it could be anything.
Right.
Or it could be something really deeply philosophical, you know, that he's asking. So he kind of leaves it to the person to decipher what level they're willing to address the
question. And where they're going to start with him.
Yes.
And it's interesting you said that because even though this exact phrase isn't used in every one of his conversations, he doesn't start with this all the time. He starts with this tone and attitude. Mm-hmm. So he always starts with where the person is. He doesn't come with a preconceived agenda or I've got to get to this point in the conversation. And we should learn from that because I know as a preacher, I can come into a conversation with my kids, with neighbors, with this preconceived, I've got to get to this, or if I don't get to this point. Jesus starts with being hospitable in the conversation. We need to also take the pressure off ourselves of saying, okay, here's my neighbor, they've allowed me to come into their home, we're having a conversation, we're getting to know each other, and I've got to get to Jesus on this right away. Well, they're going to sense that. We just need to hear. And hear their heart. Hear where they are.
What's interesting, though, is that they don't answer the question. Then they flip it back, and instead of answering, they ask him another question. Where are you staying?
Right.
Which seems so odd. Such a simple, superficial sort of thing.
But it may be, in their culture, where are you staying? It could be the idea that we'll follow you. It was very common if they would find where they're staying. Maybe they'll go sit and have a long dinner with him, and they can converse about the concepts. And so they're probably wanting to continue the conversation with this question. And he doesn't answer the question directly. He goes to the idea of come and see.
Right. I remember hearing Rick Warren talk about the three levels of commitment that Jesus calls us to. Mm-hmm. And he said, it starts here with the come and see, and then it's come and follow, and then it's come and die. And it just was really helpful for me to understand that this is a progression. And even when we talk to other people,
we sometimes are so cautious about having a conversation that we don't even get to the come and see. We know someone for a number of years, 15, 20 years, and we never indicate we're a follower of Christ or what our faith is all about. We need to get to come and see with people. And the other extreme, though, is people know someone for like 1 minute, and without a natural introduction right. into it, they're really into it, and they're maybe right at come and die, you know. And I think there's, again, something so beautiful, even in how Jesus talks with the two who follow, which are Andrew and probably John. He doesn't name himself as one of the two disciples that had followed John the Baptist and now follow Jesus. Then it says they go at 4 o'clock in the evening. They spend time with him. There's an implication in the text, especially what's talked about the next day, that maybe a few others joined them for conversation with Jesus that evening. And the next day he says to Philip, come and follow. And so probably Philip had heard maybe in that conversation the night before, the come and see, like the two who had been disciples following John the Baptist. And so there's a beautiful progression right here in this text.
Well, and then in verse 46, Philip then goes to Nathanael and says, come and see for yourselves. So he's already picked up on, this is the model.
And he hasn't even heard the come and die yet.
Right.
But he understands there's something different about Jesus. There's something that's drawn him in. And I think, of course, Jesus is the Son of God. They're getting a sense of that. But I also think it's Jesus, hospitable, gracious, open spirit to invite them into his life, to invite them into a conversation, and to have a natural, intentional conversation with them that spurs them to say, we got to go find others to hear this and come and see this guy. And he goes to Nathanael and says that.
And these people that they go to, the first disciples go to, are people they know.
Yeah, this is not some abrupt Jesus goes around saying, you, okay, that's 12, you're in, follow me, get in the back, we're going. This is a relational, conversational journey, and John is the one who gives us the most insight even into this kind of interaction with this many disciples.
And I have a question for you, Sean, because I was curious when I was reading the text about Nathanael, and when he says, can anything good come from Nazareth? When Jesus is pointed out to him, he has a skepticism about anything good come out of Nazareth. Why does he make this comment?
Well, Nazareth was a nasty town. I mean, it was a terrible, terrible place. And so he's going, how can there be something good out of there? There's nothing spiritual or good comes out of Nazareth. And so he's questioning who Jesus is. And I think that's a natural question that comes up when we try to share Christ with others, is people want to say, well, I've heard this about Jesus or that about Jesus, or you know, this television documentary proved Jesus wasn't who he said he was. What do you say? And Jesus doesn't panic. He doesn't panic. He doesn't come out with a 5-page paper, this explains who I am. He invites him into relationship.
Right. I remember when I was practicing, a lot of people would say, I had a number of people say, how can you be a Christian and be a lawyer?
Wait, you're a lawyer?
Right. Yeah. The idea that somehow some things about our life causes people to kind of go, Christian means this, you're right. This, therefore
well,
it doesn't match.
One of my hurdles, not everybody has this hurdle, but one of my hurdles is my neighbors know I'm a pastor.
That's a hurdle?
Well, it's a hurdle because they're very cautious. Mm. I even found that more in Southern California outside the Bible Belt than I did back east. I remember the first Halloween I was here, we just moved in and I was handing out candy and some parents came along. They knew the house had been empty for a while and now we've moved in. And they said, well, what do you do? And when I said I was a pastor, the conversation was going great when I said I was a pastor. Every time
done.
They would say, okay, kids, we're ready to go to the next house, because they're waiting for me to unload on them a spiritual conversation. They're trying to bring them to my church. And so for me, I have that hurdle. I think we all have different hurdles. Maybe we told people we're a Christian and then we went through something in our lives that demonstrated our own brokenness. And they're saying, well, he's been telling me for 5 years he's a Christian. Now he's going through this, or he's done this, or I know this about him. And so I think it needs to be, for us, this hospitable spirit like Jesus has, not giving too much right up front because people can't handle it, but invite them in and walk the journey with them wherever they are.
And we have to remember that we're not inviting them necessarily to follow us. We're
right.
inviting them to see Jesus,
yeah.
which is very different.
Our attitude is like the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 11:1 when he says, follow me as I follow Jesus.
So what are some practical ways that we can be hospitable and be like Jesus and inviting people to come and see?
Well, I think part of it is our spirit and our tone with them, that we can be natural, having a conversation. Let it just be what comes to mind and what you talk about. And then there is, you know, invite them to an event at church, invite them into your small group, invite them to a worship service. Because then when someone comes to something like that, it may spark more questions from them.
Right.
It sparks opportunities to answer, what was that lyric in that song? Why did you say that phrase? Why did your pastor say this? I remember back at Easter, someone shared with me the story that for months she'd been sharing with her stylist that Easter was coming. And that was backed up by years of praying and trying to have a conversation with her stylist that would lead to spiritual conversation. And she had invited the stylist. What she didn't know was another person at Calvary was inviting the stylist that was next to the first one in the shop there. And so there'd been these invitations going on, and these two were talking to each other about these invitations, and so both families ended up coming at Easter.
That's so cool.
And the person who emailed me said it was so wonderful and so cool because there was an email came to each of these individuals from those that invited that asked more questions, asked about, can we come back? Is it okay to come back? Those kinds of things. And sometimes we've been a Christian even for a year or two or for a decade or for some of us many decades, we forget some of the common things that someone who doesn't know Jesus is going to ask about. And we've got to be welcoming and inviting, and even inviting someone to something at church. We even do intentional activities like our Star of Wonder or 4th of July. We do specific things to try to welcome folks. And so I think that's a great starting point in being hospitable. More and more in our culture, we have people who have never been in church.
Right.
Their parents didn't take them. They haven't gone, maybe for a wedding, a funeral, but that's about it. And the more that happens, the more the side doors will be key because the service itself can be intimidating.
Right.
And it's not very relational. That's why in the small group settings too, I think we have to be very open to inviting. And I would say we appreciate when you as small groups invite folks in who've signed up for small groups. Not everybody who signs up for small groups are believers.
Yes.
Because they're searching. They've been attending for a while. Now they say, that'd be kind of cool to sit with some people and talk about the Bible and conversations that matter. And so we've got to be very aware, even in our small groups, that those places are now the entry points. They're not the destinations after people come to the main service.
Right. And part of being hospitable and just in our everyday life is to just have that spirit of openness and engaging with people wherever we are. And I think maybe one of the barriers is that it kind of disrupts our schedule. I mean, why don't we do this more? Why don't we just do what Jesus says? Come hang out with me.
Yeah, I think part of the thing is that a lot of people have false expectations on themselves for what's required in these conversations. I should have gone to seminary. Sean could do this, so maybe I'll get him to church and that'll happen. I've got to know theology. I've got to be able to answer all the questions. I've got to be able to defend the faith.
Or this is just too much stress.
Stress?
People panic
when a question's asked that's something they don't readily have a quick answer for. You know, I know the Bible says this, or why do religious people think this, or what do you think about these types of people, or this political issue? We don't need to panic. We don't need to get fearful. As we walk with Jesus, we can just share Jesus. If you don't know what to say to answer the theological questions or defend the scriptures or defend Jesus and who he was and is, share what he's done in your life. Share, you know, it's kind of like the blind man. They ask him a lot of theological questions. He says, you know what, I don't know a lot about this guy. But I know one thing. I once was blind, but now I see. And I think that's the spirit of just saying, hey, I can't answer all that. I can help you get to people who can. But can I share with you what it's meant for me since I put my faith in Jesus? Can I tell you what God's word has done for me? Can I tell you the hope I have now? How that's changed my home life, my work life, and how it's made me more satisfied in life. I have peace and joy. I think it's a spirit of inviting people into our lives and into this journey, not just into one conversation.